After the vote on the fiscal cliff, there was another, a different spending spat that divided the Republican Party. House Republican leaders refused to take up an aid package for victims of Hurricane Sandy, which the president had called for and the Senate had approved earlier.
From the moment the House convened today, bipartisan anger filled the chamber. Lawmakers from New York, New Jersey, and Connecticut said the failure to vote on Hurricane Sandy aid was a betrayal.
We cannot believe that this cruel knife in the back was delivered to our region.
They said, "You are on your own." My friends, our people cannot be on their own.
The Senate approved a $60 billion storm recovery measure last Friday. House leaders had been considering a pared-down version when Speaker John Boehner pulled the bill last night. A number of Republicans had insisted on offsetting spending cuts. But Boehner's decision was lambasted by New Jersey's Republican Governor Chris Christie, who charged storm victims have already waited too long.
America deserves better than just another example of a government that has forgotten who they are there to serve and why. 66 days and counting. Shame on you. Shame on Congress. It is why the American people hate Congress. It's why they hate them.
And President Obama pressed for action in a written statement. It read, in part, "I urge Republicans in the House of Representatives to bring this important request to a vote today and pass it without delay for our fellow Americans." This afternoon, Speaker Boehner met with the New York and New Jersey delegations. And Congressman King of New York emerged later to say they had gotten what they wanted after all.
$9 billion flood insurance this Friday will be voted on. And then on January 15th, the first full legislative day, will be the additional $51 billion will be voted on. And that will come to a total of 60, which was what the total was of the bill that was supposed to be voted on this week.
The votes will be taken by the new Congress that is due to be sworn in tomorrow.
Still here with us are Stephen Dennis of Roll Call and Neil Irwin of The Washington Post. And Stephen, Governor Christie was very angry. Congressman King, others from the Northeast, very angry. What happened here?
It was almost, it was amazing to see almost a meltdown on the House floor last night with all of these members, Republican members, coming to the House floor and just ripping into their leadership, saying that they felt they had been lied to, that they were going to get this before they went home, and then it went poof. And basically, our understanding is the Speaker basically decided, look, we just had this big fight over the fiscal cliff. Everybody's angry about the lack of spending cuts. And then we're going to have a bill that spends, you know, $30 or $60 billion, depending on which bill they ended up bringing to the floor. I think that that was something that ended up being a PR nightmare for them, to have hour after hour, whether it be Chris Christie or Pete King or whoever, going on the news and saying, hey, don't give any money to the Republican Party if you're in New York or New Jersey. But and, within a day, they backpedaled and, you know, this thing is going to start, you know, on Friday. They're going to get $10 billion. And
changed his mind very quickly. Yes. They're going to vote. In a couple of weeks, they'll vote on the rest of it. So they are going to apparently get this money now.
Yeah, but, you know, it does show a difference between the Republican Party today and where they were during Katrina. They passed Katrina aid, big package, in a week. You know, this new party needs, you know, they want those cuts. They're not happy with just, you know, spending tens of billions of dollars without anything offsetting it.
So, Neil Irwin, how much money are we talking about here for Hurricane Sandy? The number was $60 billion. $60 billion. It sounds like a lot of money.
It's a lot of money. It's $60 billion. It's a lot of money by any measure. But we're in a government that spends $2 trillion a year. We're in a $15 trillion economy. And the thing to remember, that's emergency spending. It's one time. It doesn't change the structural long-term deficit picture by much. So it's not a huge number in the scheme of things, but it gets back to this ideological issue of, okay, when something bad happens, when we have a devastating storm, is the government going to write a check and help that area and help people rebuild and spend whatever it takes to do that? Or are we going to have a long, contentious legislative debate to figure out how to offset that spending elsewhere? And that ideological debate really came up at an inopportune time for a Republican Party that's already frayed in a lot of ways.
I know some of the Republicans were saying this money should have been offset mm-hmm. with spending cuts, and it wasn't, or it won't be, I guess, is the view right now.
It appears that way. I think the situation is still in flux, even as we speak, and we'll see how it shakes out.
So that's one of the things that didn't get done. It's going to be reversed. But there were other things, Neil, that people are looking at the overall impact of this legislation and saying, wait a minute, the deficit reduction is what? We were originally talking at the $4 trillion level. Where does it end up?
Well, it depends on how you count, whether you count assuming that the entire Bush tax cuts had stayed in place and there had been no change, or if you if your baseline is instead the expiration of those cuts that had been envisioned. Either way you slice it, though, this is not a huge deficit reduction. This is this is really about the president getting his way to a degree on taxes, and the Republicans getting those Bush tax cuts locked in and getting some other things they like to see. This is not changing in a major way. This is not the long-term deficit reduction deal the nation will eventually need. This isn't the long-term tax reform deal we might need. This isn't fixing a lot of the long-term problems we face. This is a deal to get us to see another day.
And Stephen, that means that there are other fights coming. They put off the so-called sequester vote, these automatic across-the-board spending cuts. That's going to come up pretty quickly.
Well, I think actually this deal makes it harder to do the next deal and harder to do the big deal, because they've now taken, a big carrot for Democrats, these tax revenues. Those are out the door, and Republicans are going to be much less likely to have additional tax revenues. The president wanted $1.2 trillion. Is he going to get another $600 billion in a couple of months out of this House Republicans? I don't think so. So, and you have this debt ceiling. You have a debt ceiling looming in a couple of months. John Boehner has something called the Boehner Rule, which I think is going to become the new fiscal cliff keyword. The Boehner Rule says, hey, you want $1 in deficit increase? I want $1 in deficit cuts. I want $1 in spending cuts. And the president is saying, I'm not going to negotiate at all. So, and that strikes in 2 months. That's somebody's going to have to give on that. And, it could get really ugly really fast.
If you're Neil or Irwin, if you're looking at this economy right now and you're looking at this legislation, does it have an impact on the American economy, on unemployment?
So there's some mild negatives that come from the higher taxes, especially the payroll tax credit, payroll tax holiday we talked about. Even higher income tax rates are a negative for growth. But that said, this economy has been plugging along. What Steve's talking about are some really dangerous things, which is we're heading now into another standoff over the debt ceiling. We all remember how that worked out in August of 2011. It hurt business confidence. It floated this possibility of a federal government default. We had a credit downgrade of the U.S. credit rating. Those are all things that really undermined business confidence and made 2011 a worse year than it otherwise would have been. The risk now is that in this next round of brinksmanship and negotiation, we might see that all over again. Let's hope that this is a crisper series of negotiations that aren't quite as scary for businesses and the economy.
But in a word, Stephen, is that something that members on both sides in the White House are prepared to do?
I see a lot more brinksmanship. I think it could get very, very ugly. And there's, we might yet test that theory that it's going to take, the markets freaking out again before they come up with another deal.
We can all only hope that that's not going to happen. Stephen Dennis, Neil Irwin, we thank you both.
Thank you.
There's more on all this online, including a way for you to see how your state's congressional delegation voted.